technology at the Bhupat and Jyoti Mehta School of Biosciences at IIT Madras. His research group works on the development of algorithms and computational tools for understanding, predicting, and manipulating complex biological networks. His research broadly spans computational aspects of synthetic and systems biology. Key areas of research in his group encompass microbiome analysis, in silico, metabolic engineering, biological network design, and biological data analysis. He also coordinates the Center for Integrative Biology and Systems Medicine, IBSC, at IIT Madras, and is a core member of Robert Bosch Center for Data Science and Artificial Intelligence, the RBC DSAI at IIT Madras. Dr. Karthik teaches courses on computational biology and systems biology at IIT Madras and has also authored a textbook, which is very impressive, on computational systems biology. So with that, I would like to leave the stage with Dr. Karthik Raman. It's all to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Ganesh, for the introduction. And thank you all for putting together a nice summit with a very interesting focus on tools and so on. So I've actually tried to frame a fairly different talk from what I usually give. So this is trying to focus a lot more on some of the tools and algorithms that we have developed in our lab over the last several years. So we are an interdisciplinary group focusing on computational approaches to understand and manipulate biological networks. We are particularly into looking at scalable algorithms for metabolic network analysis. And more recently, we've been really focusing on microbial communities, trying to understand their interactions and so on. And the key applications we look at are in, of course, trying to get biological understanding, improved biological insights and so on, but also in terms of industrial applications for metabolic engineering and so forth. And we also do a lot of analysis of multiomic biological data and clinical big data, and we work closely with IBSC and RBC DSAI. So these are some of the tools and algorithms that we've developed so far, and the ones that I've highlighted in are the ones I'm going to focus on a little more in today's talk. So we have algorithms for enumerating synthetic lethals in metabolic pathways, or enumerating alternate pathways in metabolic networks, network-based approaches to predict and identify essential genes in protein-protein functional association networks, and so on. And we also have a little bit of work on cancer genomics and so on. But since this session is more related to systems biology, I'm going to focus more on the other tools. And if I have time, I will just make a brief mention on some of the cancer genomic pipelines that we've developed. And there is also a poster from our lab if you're interested in looking at it. Okay, so with that, let me start with a brief introduction to genome scale metabolic networks. So you may all have seen such pictures adorning the walls of many people, especially biochemists, but even others. So what are these genome scale metabolic networks? They're basically a large collection of all metabolic reactions that happen in these organisms, along with information about what enzymes catalyze these and so on. And they've been reconstructed for a large number of organisms. So they essentially present a very comprehensive picture of what is known about an organism's biochemistry. Yeah. And it is also possible to directly reconstruct these draft reconstructions from databases such as the model seed and so on. And there are a lot of methods to analyze these networks today. And I'll try to focus on the methods that we have developed, build on some of these approaches. And for those of the students in the audience, you may want to check out these databases. They contain a wealth of information for building metabolic networks and trying to understand this extremely complex system. And what can genome scale metabolic networks tell us? Right. So this is a nice picture from an oldish paper now, which talks about 250 studies that use the E. coli reconstruction alone. Right. And today I'm sure there are probably over 500 studies that have used the E. coli reconstruction and several other reconstructions and so on. And if you see, a lot of studies are focused on metabolic engineering, and that's something that we also really like a lot. And also biological network properties is something else that people have looked at. And you also have people who've studied evolutionary processes, interspecies interaction. But a couple of things that are really interesting, especially in the context of today's talk, are model-driven discovery. So, for example, can you figure out new biology from through your model predictions, right? New interactions and new annotations and so on. And also, can you predict cellular phenotypes? Can you predict what happens to a cell under different conditions? And can you use it to understand a little bit more about the underlying biology and so on? So with that, I'm going to move over to synthetic lethals. This is something that is really interesting. So what are these? These are sets of genes or reactions where only the simultaneous removal of the genes or reactions abolishes growth. Meaning, if you remove a single gene, like PQR here or ABC here, the cell still grows. But when you remove the two genes together, say ABC and PQR, simultaneously, you see that the organism dies. So which means that, you know, perhaps these two are compensating for each other in a particular way or whatever. Or, you know, there are parallel pathways where these occur, genes occur, and removing either of these genes disrupts these parallel pathways and so on. There are lots of applications for synthetic lethals. First and foremost, understanding gene function and functional associations. This talks about how two genes may be functionally associated with each other, right? Even though they may not be in the same pathway. They may be in probably parallel pathways or whatever. And combinatorial drug targeting against pathogens, because there is this notion of how weak hits can confuse complex systems, and two non-lethal targets together may at times be more useful for targeting than a single strong target. And then there is also this notion of collateral lethality or synthetic lethality in cancer therapy, wherein you try to identify the healthy cells typically don't harbor any of these deletions. But let's say, you know, there is a cancer cell that has a particular mutation. And if you find something that is synthetically lethal with that and you target that, it can be selectively targeting only cancer cells, because the healthy cells do not have one of the flaws of the cancer cell, at least, right? So there is some gene that has gone awry in the cancer cell, and whereas in the healthy cell that gene remains. But in the cancer cell, one gene is lost already. It's probably, you know, something that has sparked up the tumor, and then you find a gene that is synthetic lethal with that gene. It can actually help in targeting these cells selectively. So it's still early days, but then these are very useful applications for and good motivation of why we need to study synthetic lethals. So we built an algorithm called FastSL, and it basically builds on flux balance analysis. But it's a nice perspective on this old algorithm, because we came up with a very different approach from previous algorithms. A lot of previous algorithms used mixed integer linear programming formulation and things like that. Whereas Aditya came up with this very nice approach to cut through the search space of the synthetic lethals by systematically analyzing various aspects of the space, right? So what reactions are redundant and what reactions need not carry a flux under certain conditions, and so on. And by reducing the search space, we managed to really cut down the computation time drastically. And if you see, as I was mentioning, the previous approaches have used this approach called flux balance analysis. For those of you who are familiar with it, it's a constraint-based approach. Basically, mass balance and linear programming applied to large reaction systems. And you know, there are people who've also exhaustively searched the space, basically paralyzing it on a large cluster or something like that, or posing it as a mixed integer linear programming problem, which gets incrementally hard to solve and so on. But what we did basically circumvents the complexities of previous approaches, and by just cutting through the search space. So we ended up solving only 1 in 4,000 LPs or something like that, to come up with the same exact, there is no approximation here, it's just a question of smart elimination of the search space. And we also could systematically evaluate gene deletions. And we also did it on a cluster just for fun's sake to show that, you know, even though we proved the algorithm, we also demonstrated that our results agreed with exhaustive enumeration. And the real use of FastSSS in trying to identify functional associations or combinatorial drug targets and so on. And in terms of combinatorial drug targets, you find that only a few combinatorial deletions abolish growth in silico. So even though you study this, you have an organism with say 1,000 genes, you look at 1,000 choose two combinations roughly. But it turns out to be only a handful of these that are actually interesting in the end. But you know that is where the challenge comes in, because you have to do a lot of simulations to identify the small spectrum of interesting synthetic lethals or deletions. So we found that about 28 triple gene deletions or 20 double gene deletions in Mycobacterium tuberculosis have no homologs in human. So these could be interesting as drug targets perhaps. And there are many other doublets in Salmonella typhimurium that have no homologs and so on. So these are quite interesting, and these are now readily available from a database which we call CASL. So this database has synthetic lethal predictions for 100 plus organisms. So if you're working with any of these genes, or you know you're just tinkering with some of these, you can go and look them up in this database to see if there is something interesting in the genes or proteins that you are studying. And of course, this computes it only for like a particular environmental condition and so on. It is possible to extend it if you want to tinker with the algorithm itself, right? So you can get FastSSL from GitHub too, and you can run it on any particular scenario that you are interested in. Okay, so this is one of the tools that we developed. So with that, I'll switch gears and move to something that really occupies our lab's time for the present moment, which is trying to identify microbial interactions in various kinds of communities. So I'll give you a quick introduction to microbial communities. I'm sure at this point of time, everybody is well aware of microbial communities because things like the gut microbiome are always in the news and in the science news cycle and so on. And we know that microbes are ubiquitous, but they do not exist in isolation, of course, and they thrive in complex environments, dynamic environments. But in all of these environments, there is a very interesting community structure that develops. And there are some organisms that help the other organisms, there are some organisms that really thrive on other organisms, and so on. So there is some competition, some cooperation, some selfishness, some altruism. All of these things are seen in microbial communities. But it turns out that very interestingly, metabolic interactions predominate in these communities. So by studying the metabolic interactions between these organisms, one can develop a much deeper understanding of how a community functions and how it is structured and so on. And of course, we are very interested in various microbiomes, like it could be the soil, it could be the gut, it could be the skin, and so on, because all of these have very interesting implications for, say, ranging from agriculture to health and disease and things like that. Of course, microbial consortia are also interested in interesting for metabolic engineering. You do see that there are a number of bioprocesses today that employ consortia for producing various molecules. This is simply because there are certain advantages such as division of labor and utilization of multiple substrates that a given consortium provides over like a single organism. And obviously the understanding of interactions is crucial, be it in trying to understand microbial consortia for metabolic biotechnological applications, or even for understanding the gut microbiome. I'll also show you a nice interesting example of how, you know, we were able to understand how the gut recovers post antibiotic treatment. The gut microbiome is a very complex ecosystem. So very famous Nature cover image, which says it's a other genome. It's probably the most important metabolic organ in the body after the liver, with many roles in the health and disease and various kinds of diseases, right from, you know, the gastrointestinal diseases to even neural neural disorders and so on. The composition itself is highly variable of the gut microbiome, depending on the stage of life, diet, and environmental exposure. And more importantly, antibiotic usage. This is very common, very rampant, if you will, in a lot of places, especially in India. And this can really affect the gut, cause gut dysbiosis with a lot of collateral damage to these gut flora. They're not intended targets of your antibiotics, but they end up being collateral damage. This induces change in composition. So your gut microbiome profile moves from one particular place to another, and can you sort of restore it to the healthy configuration, so to speak. So the question is, how can we understand microbial interactions in communities such as the gut? Can we use metabolic models? Of course, that's what we try to do always, try to build metabolic models to try and understand various systems, including communities. There are various ways to model microbial communities. So there are constraint-based approaches, there are graph-based approaches, there are population-based or agent-based approaches, and so on. And there are a few challenges in terms of the availability of models and trying to merge and mix models that have been developed, curated by different groups and things like that. In all of these models, the standard thing to look at is what kind of metabolic interactions can happen, what kind of exchanges can happen. So maybe, you know, one of the organisms breaks down glucose, produces a metabolite that is passed on to a second organism, which further processes it for its own growth. So this metabolite may not be fully utilized in the first organism, but it is very advantageous when it is used up in the second organism, and it finally helps the community grow better and so on. So this is something that's very interesting to look at. And here we'll move over to graph theory. So you already have some notion of graph theory from Ganesh talk, where you have these flavor networks or ingredient networks and things like that. But here we have a metabolic network, which we want to convert to a graph. So how do you convert it to a graph? So you can make a substrate graph, which is very sort of simplistic, where glucose is converted to glucose, it's phosphate, and so on. But then there is a small challenge here, because I'm not sure on ATP, ADP here, but if you were to have ATP, ADP in the mix, you may conclude that glucose can be converted to ADP and ADP can be converted to pyruvate, yielding a two-step glycolysis, which really does not happen in reality. The other approach is something called a reaction graph. This is not widely used, wherein you just look at reactions connecting to one another based on the metabolites that they share and so on. The most interesting part is probably the bipartite graph, or what's also known as a hypergraph, where you have two sets of nodes, the circular nodes that represent metabolites and the squarish nodes that represent reactions. And what you see is metabolites will only connect to reactions, and reactions will connect only to metabolites. And here you can have ATP also going here, and you can say that both glucose and ATP are needed for the hexokinase reaction to happen, which will produce G6P and ADP and the things like that. So this is a very powerful formalism, but it's a little challenging to analyze, which is why you need efficient algorithms and data structures to interrogate these kinds of bipartite metabolic networks. And I already mentioned to you the issue with currency metabolites. They need to be eliminated from substrate graphs, whereas we don't really care about them in the bipartite graph representation. So we have an algorithm called MetQuest, and we are running a short tutorial on this later this week if you're interested. I have the coordinates in the last slide. And this algorithm is very useful to dissect metabolic networks. It's very scalable, which means that you can even apply it to much larger microbial communities and so on. So what is it? It's essentially a dynamic programming based enumeration, which assembles all reactions that are necessary for the production of a particular molecule into groups of, in fact, we assemble them into pathways, which we call directed acyclic graphs, essentially clusters of reactions that are together necessary to produce a particular metabolite given a starting set of molecules. So if those of you familiar with graph theory will immediately recognize breadth first search. So it's a very simple standard technique. In fact, all of you use breadth first search when you travel and use Google Maps. So there is a shortest path algorithm that's basically built something like on breadth first search, but in reality, of course, it's a bit on Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm. And in the second phase, the reactions that are first identified through breadth first search are then assembled into pathways. So this is implemented in both Python 3 and Python 2, and you can get it from just pip install netlist and you'll have it. So it is a dynamic programming based enumeration, and the important part is it can study what kind of metabolites are exchanged between organisms and communities, and trying to identify what kind of interactions can possibly happen. So how much does this particular organism support the metabolism of this organism, and things like that. So the most important aspect of this algorithm is it's very scalable, and it can work on large communities. So you can have communities with say tens of organisms, several thousand reactions, and it is still able to give you very quick predictions and calculations. So some key features are we require only the topology of the reaction network. We don't even so much bother about stoichiometry or more complex things like atom-atom mapping, which are not readily available. It is very scalable, as I already mentioned. It can also efficiently handle cycles, because in metabolic network, cycles are a very common occurrence, and they can be a very touchy issue for several graph algorithms and so on. And so we have a way of handling cycles and branch pathways very nicely here. And it also looks at multiple alternative routes of conversion. So there may be one preferred pathway, but there are many other possible routes to reach a particular metabolite through biochemically feasible pathways. So what are the inputs to the algorithm? We have a directed bipartite graph that either derived from a single metabolic network or from a community of metabolic networks. And then a set of seed metabolites. And the output is a bunch of So it's a directed bipartite graph from a given metabolic network, a set of seed metabolites, a set of target metabolites, and also an integer that bounds the size of the pathway. We are not interested in very long pathways and so on. What are your seed metabolites? This is akin to the medium that this organism grows on, at least the minimum medium that it requires to survive and so on. So this is something that needs to be computed. And this is how the directed bipartite graph looks like. So you have metabolites that connect to reactions and reactions that connect to metabolites. And depending upon, for example, this metabolite, there is no way to, this is not available in the system yet. So this reaction cannot happen. The other reactions can all happen. So this representation is able to actually capture these kinds of behaviors. The output of our algorithm is the scope of metabolites, which essentially tells you what are all the reactions that can fire in this context. So we designate reactions as either visited or stuck and things like that. So, and the presence of a new organism in the community can alleviate some of these stuck reactions, enabling the metabolism of a given organism. So these are very helpful. These are the kind of interactions that build microbial communities. So we assemble these reactions into pathways. I'll not get into detail, but finally the output is a sort of table like this. So if you want to produce metabolite M8 using three reactions, there is one way to do it. You can do R1, R3, and R6. You cannot produce it with fewer than three reactions. And similarly, metabolites M3 and M4, you can produce it using two reactions, but you can't produce it with more or less reactions, and so on. So in larger networks, this becomes a much larger table, and we needed some computational ingenuity that was provided by Aarti and Meghna, which enabled this to happen. I already mentioned a couple of times that this approach is scalable. So you see, we could apply it to a network that had 14,000 nodes and 30,000 edges, and with as many as 1,000 plus metabolites being produced in the network. And we looked at pathways of size 20 in this large network comprising three organisms. We have now even gone up to 10 plus organisms and things like that. We look at an entire community and we remove a single organism out of it to see what is the impact on the community and so many applications. So but the most important one is to really quantify how organisms benefit from one another in communities. So this is very interesting. We also did some experimental studies to corroborate some of our predictions and so on. The most interesting thing though is you get to identify what are the key metabolic exchanges. And in fact, it's very interesting in communities such as the gut to see how certain short chain fatty acids or certain amino acids are being exchanged and really promote the growth of particular organisms and things like that. And currently we are studying a bunch of microbiomes, not just limited to the gut. And the International Space Station microbiome, you can see our preprint on bioarchive, it's really interesting. And we also look at the deep sea hydrothermal vents in the Guaymas Basin. This is another very interesting microbiome where you have a lot of extremophiles with very, very different kinds of metabolisms and very, very interesting kind of dependencies. And we are also looking at the ocular microbiome and other such interesting microbiomes. So a quick application insight on how the gut microbiome recovers post antibiotic treatment. So this is a beautiful illustration which shows that this is a forest destroyed by a forest fire, and then it slowly the ecosystem recovers over a period of time. Similarly, antibiotics are the forest fire for the gut. They really, you know, decimate the microbiome in various ways, but then slowly the gut microbiome recovers. It turns out that, you know, the gut microbiome recovers post antibiotic treatment, but much faster in certain individuals compared to other individuals. And this turns out to be because there are a bunch of organisms that seem to accelerate recovery. And this is the most interesting part. So there are about 20 species of organisms that are recovery associated bacteria, which have improved carbohydrate degrading capacity and things like that. And but there are also specific organisms that seem to have a very interesting role here. And why do these organisms work well together? And from our computational studies, we found that these recovery-associated bacteria typically have much higher, you know, they work much better together. They function as a group much better than the other organisms. And we looked at, I'll just show you a simple network diagram, which these are some of the top interactions that we found. There are many more interactions that exist, but these are some of the top interactions, and some of these have been shown in vivo models to quickly help the gut recover and so on. So in mice models, administering Bacteroides theta etomicron and Bifidobacterium adolescentis helped the gut to resuscitate much faster following antibiotic treatment. There are such edges and many organisms that are contributing towards the improvement of gut health. And I think these kinds of models and the exchanges, metabolic exchanges between these organisms can be very helpful in identifying specific organisms and potentially design new therapeutic strategies or, for example, these concoctions of probiotics that one needs to take alongside an antibiotic treatment and so on. So if you want more on metabolic modeling of microbiomes, do check out our tutorial. You can also check out MedQuest or some of our papers and this monograph. So with that, you know, I'm going to go switch gears and go walk more towards machine learning, slowly more and more towards machine learning and the intersection with systems biology. So we looked at predicting essential genes in protein-protein interaction networks. This is very interesting simply because you have essential gene data only for a handful of organisms. Even if you really dug into literature, you would find that essential genes are available for maybe about 30 organisms, at best 30, maybe 50, I think, with the latest release of the database of essential genes. But you have interactomes available for thousands of organisms. Can you exploit this to essentially identify what are more likely to be essential genes? You may all have seen this picture, a classic picture of the yeast protein-protein interaction network. It's which talks about which shows that there are some red nodes and some green nodes and some yellow nodes depending upon whether a protein is essential, non-essential, or a slow grower, and so on. And this was the fundamental paper on the what is known as the centrality lethality hypothesis. And but that's only a hypothesis. It basically states that nodes with higher degree are more likely to be essential and so on. But that doesn't really tell you much, right? So more likely means what? You may have a node with very, very high degree that's not at all essential and things like that. For example, if it were duplicated. So it is not possible to just look at a single network parameter and predict all of this. But there's still this notion, or we had this question, that protein function or essentiality really could depend on network position and parameters. So not just on a single parameter, like how many neighbors, which is what degree is, which is what the general notion of centrality is. But can we actually leverage network information to predict essential genes? Can we use a combination of features that capture various aspects? For example, those that capture the global, local, and neighborhood properties. So there are methods that have been developed in literature called recursive feature extraction and so on, and also role-based network centralities and things like that, and other centrality measures. Right? I'm sure all of you are familiar with, or if you with the PageRank, or if you don't know, you can look up a little more about it. It's a fascinating algorithm from Google, which sort of is one of the main reasons behind their search dominance. We looked at several potent network-based features to predict gene essentiality, and we found that even like a handful of features can give you very high accuracy for classification. And remember, these are pure network features. There are people who use sequence-based features. They don't perform that well. But if you integrate sequence and network, there is a marginal improvement. But pure network alone can really give you very interesting insights. And that is what we've now integrated into this database called NetGenes. I invite you all to explore. What we did was we basically applied the pipeline from the previous study that I showed, which Karthik did, to a whole set of string interactomes. We took 2,700 interactomes from the string, and with this as the training data, with a bunch of features extracted, we then made predictions on all of these 2,700 interactomes. Right? So you can check it out. It provides essentiality scores, annotations, and also pure feature vectors if you are interested in building a better classifier and things like that. So this work and this entire database was built by Sendamir, along with Professor Ravindran from RBCDC. So I think I have only a few more minutes, and I want to give sufficient time for questions, but I will quickly step through some of this, and this will also sort of attract you to our poster on this very same topic. So we have a GUI-driven bioinformatics pipeline for analyzing cancer omics data. We call it ICOMIC, and it has, you know, several tools for whole genome data analysis and also for RNA-seq data analysis. But the thing is, it's all GUI based. So you don't have to know any command line parameters. You can even tune the command line parameters via the GUI. But you can just click the default parameters and run, and you'll get a point and click application for those who are not yet familiar with programming and so on. And we have a bunch of tools that are incorporated. And for quality control, alignment, variant calling, and so on. And this is how the interface looks like. You can just load some of your files. It's or even an entire folder of samples, and just run the pipeline of the whole thing. So these are all just out of the box. It runs. You don't have to install anything. You just install, do like something like Conda install ICOMIC, and you have the whole thing. And this also incorporates some custom algorithms that we've developed in our group for identifying tumor suppressor genes and oncogenes genes and so on. And this algorithm is particularly interesting because most driver genes have low mutation rate related to background. So the algorithms that use background-based, like just frequency-based approaches to identify these aren't good enough. So we were able to identify a lot many more novel genes and things like that. And that is simply because we use machine learning rather than just looking at the frequency and things like that. And most recently, we have this algorithm called NVDriver, which predicts driver mutations from just neighborhood information. So, one way of looking at some of this work is that we use as minimal information as possible. Right? So, for example, in MedQuest, we try to use just the metabolic network, no stoichiometry, atom mapping information, and so on. In NetGenes, we again used just the network information, no other biological information and things like that, no sequence, etc. And in NVDriver, we again use just the sequence information. We do not use any other information, or for example, one could integrate more information as from RNA-seq data, things like that. But with just sequence information, we are able to predict that certain mutations are more likely to be pathogenic than others, and so on. So this is a very interesting piece of study and also got a lot of press, if you spotted it recently. And with that, I'd like to conclude my talk, acknowledging a lot of these people. You've probably seen their faces through my slides. You can associate each of them with the work that they did. But a really amazing bunch of grad students and project staff who made all this happen. Would also like to thank our funders, IIT Madras, RBC-DESI, IBSC, and also the Department of Biotechnology. And with that, I'd be very happy to take questions. And please type them out in the chat box, or you can also just unmute and ask. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Karthik.